Tonight we have a very young couple joining us, a very young family joining us, and it would be interesting to hear their perspective because they're on a semi-lockdown, not really totally lockdown. First, I'm talking about Isabelle and Adrien Semblat, who are now in Hong Kong, actually. They just moved there 6 months ago. And of course, we all know that they have a very young family. So I thought tonight we're going to speak with them. We're going to carry this conversation with them to also give some tips and hope to young families who are really struggling still with this present situation. So as we said last week, we had Ben and the Isa Calzado, and really the whole purpose of these conversations is just to see how people are doing with their families, and of course to give hope, no? To be able to see that beyond this lockdown, beyond all the troubles we are facing, there's something to look forward to. There is a future to look forward to. So I'd like to welcome Belle and Adrien. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having us, Father.
Thank you, yeah. Father.
Thank you. And, you know, maybe we'd like to hear from you. You're in Hong Kong, somewhat different situation, right? Like, for example, Adrien, I heard you're still going to work every day.
Yeah, correct. So, as you said, we are in a semi-lockdown. So, we are lucky in a way in Hong Kong. So, I do go to the office every day or almost every day. I did a few days of work from home. Mm-hmm. At the office, actually, 30% of our employees are at the office. So we still have 70% of our employees that prefer to work from home. It's safer. we actually make sure at the office that we don't have any more than 4 people in each room. And whenever we have meetings, we meet with masks. And okay. We make sure we have some distances between us. So it's a different way of working.
Yeah. So it's. I guess that would be a good model for the Philippines, and as we begin to slowly open up, because we think probably we'll begin to open up maybe around May, maybe. So I think your experience is certainly a good model, no?
Okay. So,
Belle, how about you? What have you been busy with?
So I got here around 3.5 weeks ago, just before the Philippines kind of closed all its doors to traveling anywhere. And they were very strict when we arrived here in Hong Kong. We got a wristband. And in that band, you have a code and you have to download an app with your phone. And then on the phone, when you reach your house, you scan the wristband. And then it's like, it's called like the Stay at Home Safe app. So you can't leave for 14 days in your own house. So you're quarantined. After that, then you're able to, you go around. But I stay home 90% of the time. We really just go out to get the necessities. So,
yeah.
I mean, yeah, I still feel we are 80 to 90% in lockdown.
Yeah,
but we are allowed to do other things, but we don't also really go out too much, just to do the groceries. And here in Hong Kong, everyone wears masks, even the children.
Yeah.
Yeah, and everybody is constantly sanitizing.
Yeah.
I think because they experienced this whole virus and the situation ahead of us and ahead of maybe the whole world a little bit. So they were able to bounce back and really contain it.
I mean, they had the experience of SARS a couple of years ago.
Yeah, that was bad in Hong Kong. No?
So when COVID came to Hong Kong, immediately they knew how to react.
Okay. That's why you've been doing well, right? I mean, the cases are not that bad, I heard, in Hong Kong.
Yeah.
But just to give you some perspective, we have 1,000, less than 1,000, 900 plus cases over the past two months and a half in Hong Kong. In the UK, yesterday, 900 people died. So just to give you some perspective between Hong Kong and the UK,
okay, yeah.
Really under control here. There was a second wave that came to Hong Kong where we past few weeks were not really good, but still manageable.
Yeah. And France is not as bad as Spain or Italy. No, France is okay.
Yeah. France is okay, but everyone is confined. Everyone stays home. my family in France, they have to stay home.
Your brother's working though. He owns a supermarket.
I have one brother though. He works in a supermarket and he's one of the people who is required to show up to in the supermarket to actually service people.
Yeah, but of course with all the protective gears, I guess, no?
Yeah.
Even here, when you go out, you, for example, if you're choosing vegetables, you have to wear gloves to pick the vegetables. And then before you enter, they check your temperature anywhere.
But how's that? No, are people out in the streets or not really? It's practically deserted also? Or
I wouldn't say it's completely... everybody's out in the streets, like they closed restaurants and pubs, I think.
Yeah, so restaurants are still open, but 50% capacity. All bars closed, all clubs, all
schools are all closed.
Most of the hairdressers are closed. We do have people in the street, people go to work, but here everyone is very disciplined. It's very, very disciplined.
Maybe that's the difference, you know, the discipline.
How is it back in Manila now? I'm in touch with
you. It's still locked down, so streets are practically deserted. You have the supermarkets running, you have drug stores running, no restaurants open, all food delivery. It's basically, especially in the Luzon area in Metro Manila, it's basically really locked down, except for the basic services people need to go. There's no public transport. So it's pretty much a lockdown. How about there? Is the public transportation system running?
It's running, not many people.
Not many. There's no traffic, for example.
The traffic is better.
It's semi-normal. That's how I would describe it.
How about at home in your house? How do you feel now? Do you feel it's semi-normal, or you've lived here for what, 3 years? No, 3 years here in Manila.
Oh, in Manila.
Yeah, as when you got married. You got married what, 4 years ago?
3 years ago, yes.
3 years ago. So you were here for 2 years, right? Based in Manila.
So Adrien was in Manila for 10 years, and he
10
just
10 years. Moved. Ah, right. Okay.
He just moved to Hong Kong recently.
Yeah, 6 months ago.
Yeah, 6 months ago.
And so you went ahead there, Adrien, and then Belle and Basu followed.
We actually just came here 3 weeks ago. We haven't even packed up our stuff in Manila.
And I mean, it was not. They were not supposed to come 3 weeks ago, but because of what was happening, if we wanted to be together, they had no choice but to come 3 weeks ago. Because after that, it would have been very difficult for them to join.
Yeah. You were coming in and out of Manila, Adrien?
Yeah. So I was going back and forth.
I was also coming
almost
here
every weekend. Belle came a few times here. Not a bit nice from her because she had the choice to stay in Manila or come to Hong Kong, and of course she has family in Manila too, and I'm here in Hong Kong, and
I have my treadmill in Manila.
She has
but I chose Manila. to come here.
See, you're more important than the treadmill, Adrien.
So it was a good test, actually.
let's talk about the gospel for this Sunday is very interesting. It's the apostles were locked up in the room, supposedly where they had the Last Supper, no? And so they really closed the doors, locked it all up. It's almost like a lockdown, out of fear, no? Because remember, Christ had just died, and so this is supposedly right after the resurrection. Morning was the resurrection, so they were all locked up, and all of a sudden the risen Lord appears. You know, despite the locked doors. And there were three things that he told them. The first thing that he tells them is, peace be with you. It is also to let them get over their fears. And number two, I was reading up on it. They're saying that the greeting, peace be with you, was very common during that time. And so when Jesus told them, peace be with you, it was also telling them that it's me, it's really me. I'm greeting you the way I would greet you before every day. So then after that, he says, you know, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. He tells them, you have to continue the work. Then finally, the third point I wanted to talk about in the gospel was that He says, okay, do the work. I'm going to give you the spirit. I'm going to give you all the help that you need. And I wanted to talk about mission, no? Mission. And you know, our audience for this spiritual conversation are families, no? And especially now, we'd like to address the young families. And I thought, you having a very young family, and I actually read up on the article in Tatler, where you appeared with your baby, and and you were both saying that you did not plan yet for a baby, but when it came, it was certainly a blessing, and I'm sure that became a source of really, you know, somewhat center of the plans already. And I'd like you to share, you know, but before this pandemic happened, before this crisis happened, I'm sure you had plans, you had dreams, diba, for your family. How much of that has changed, no? Ever since this situation got in, no? Around just really for 2 months, no? It was first in China 2 months ago, no? But has it changed your hopes, your dreams, your plans for your family?
Go ahead.
Well, to be very honest, our plans for the family, we wanted to take a few trips to visit his parents, obviously to be with them, because we don't really see them that often. And as well as my sister, she was going to get married this year. So we had a lot of things that we were looking forward to, which obviously that's not going to happen anymore this year. Balthazar usually goes to school every single day, and that's like 3 hours off our hands where we can do a few things and work. But now he's just with me 99.9% of the time. So I think, yes, there are things that have changed, and we're just trying to adapt and we're doing the best we can to have a positive outlook and a good perspective on our situation, because we are still blessed.
Yeah, so things for the short to mid-term have changed. We had to change our plan. But I will say, if your question is about our goals in life, no, it doesn't change anything. I think we can go through this time and through those crises and still pursue those same goals. So if we want to have a bigger family in the future, this is still a goal that we have and we want to make it happen. If so, anything long term is still the same goals that you have. And it's not a virus who's going to change what we want to accomplish in life.
Yeah,
it's just a different way of going to it.
Okay, yeah. Good answer. I was talking about this year.
Yeah, it's complementary.
Yeah. No, but that's. I think it's a very good outlook. No, that, you know, the plans remain the same. I mean, some adjustments need to be made, but. And I like that, you know, when you said this virus will not change our long-term plans for our family, you know? And yeah, go ahead, Isabelle. Go ahead.
Add something. Actually, last night we did some planning, expecting that this virus is not going to bring, let's say, for example, me much work, because my businesses also have to kind of shut down and I won't be filming as well. So we are trying to prepare for that. And it's at the same time, we're thinking, how can we also lessen our expenses in order to, you know, live within our means? For example, we won't be spending so much on shopping, or, you know, we're lessening what we need, and we're putting those in priority first to see like our basic needs, just our food.
Yeah.
So that's also one way we're trying to, roll with the punches.
Yeah. So basically it's all about trying to keep the positive mindset.
Yeah.
And it's about finding the opportunity in a crisis. When we have difficult time, it always brings learnings. It always brings opportunities. And I think...
Your answers are so good.
Yeah. No, they are. They are. They're very good.
I'm not going to stop. Keep going.
No, I mean, so for families who, like us, like everyone, and some are going through terrible time, difficult moments, there is no other way but to look at the positive side. There is no other way but to look at the opportunity. Even if they are very small, those are the ones that can make me people a little bit happier and go through those tough times. And yes, so for us, for example, we realize that we have much more time together at home. So it's funny because when we are all very busy, we complain because we are too busy and we cannot have time together. And now we can probably have more time together. We complain that we cannot do other stuff. So basically, we are never fully happy, right? So it's about really take the time to pause and think about the situation and try to find the positive and the opportunity from it.
Yeah. I guess it's really trying to build your family around this opportunity now, no? It's really, because really it's the time to spend together is, I think, a gift, no? As you said, both of you were very busy, I suppose, no? When you were, like Isabelle was working, she had her businesses, she had her career, and then Adrien was the head of Adidas Philippines, right? You were the country head manager here, right? When you were assigned here. Now you have the opportunity. And so what are you looking forward to in terms of this time? I'm sure these things will not return to normal the way they used to be. No, it's gonna take time before we discover our new rhythm or the new normal, so to speak. You know? So how would you see yourself, you know, bringing, as Adrien said, how you bringing those, making people realize, look, there are opportunities here. There are opportunities for us to make things better, to be positive about it. In fact, I always tell people, you know, hopefully after this lockdown is over, it cannot be more of the same. Things have to change. No? Things have to be better, actually. Because, for example, here in the Philippines, I don't know how it is in Hong Kong, the greatest victims that you see now because of this lockdown are the poor people. You have to bring them food because most of them are daily wage earners. So I think that whole message of looking for the positive is something that maybe more and more families can really consider. And also not just look at the positive for themselves, but what can they do for those who are really more in need? You know? As you said, we are lucky. We are generally luckier and that we can live within our means, no? That's something. So what do you think? Looking forward, what could you sort of advise or suggest to people in terms of really trying to help build something better, no? As we eventually go back to the new normal?
No, I mean, one of the key learning, there are many things we can take from this, but one of the key learning is we can do things. There are not one way of doing things. There's no one way of doing things. So the thing is, a lot of things that we used to do before the virus are still being done now in a different way. So in my area, for example, is work from home, is virtual work. For all the people who actually were spending a lot of time at the office and not enough time with their family, we realized that actually we could actually do a lot of things from home. And I know in the Philippines, I mean, a lot of people spend a lot of time in the transportation going to their office or going to their job. And of course, not everyone can do that, of course, but a lot of people in the Philippines could potentially try to work from home and deliver the same in a different way. And hence, working from home, they will take all the time they will save on not going through the traffic. They could spend it with their family, take care of themselves, eating better, not eating outside, eating at home, not eating junk food, but eating better food at home, do some sport, trying to stay a bit more healthy. So that's just one example of learning of that crisis. We can do the things, but in a different way.
Yeah. Yes, Belle, yeah.
A learning from the crisis, I would say, I think people are realizing that the basic things that they have are enough to keep them happy. And I learned this from one of my best friends. She says that she always prays for just contentment. And I do the same now for my son, Balthazar, our son. Because, you know, growing up as a millennial and with social media and everything, you always want more, more, more. If you have the latest thing you want, it's never enough, right? So raising our son, we always teach him to feel like he is enough. And I always pray that he's content because we have everything that we really need. And I think with this pandemic that's happened, as long as you're with your family and you're healthy and you're able to eat 2 to 3 meals a day, 2 if you're intermittent fasting, then you should be content and grateful, and really grateful for everything, because that's all you need. I mean, this just shows us how what's the most important, right?
Yeah.
I think that was my biggest learning, that I'm like, okay,
go ahead again.
She has the best answer on this one.
No, I mean, this is really good. We're not keeping tabs. No, but, Bell 3.
But I notice you're very close to your family. No, I mean, you're. I notice that you are close to your families, your respective families.
Yes.
Yeah. But I'm sure what the two of you miss is the physical activity, the sports.
Well, yesterday we worked out here in our living room.
Yes.
Yeah. So we try to keep each other motivated. You know, it's tough also if you're, you know, with each other the whole time. So I think it's important to have your own time alone as well. Like with Adrien, I take my time out to read and just watch something on Netflix or do something on by myself. And he does the same.
Yeah.
Adrien, how about at work? How do you motivate your people? How do you help them adjust to this new, as you say, this, it's just a different context. So how are you beginning to shift things at work?
Well, I think what matters the most is really communication and constant and frequent communication about what's happening, what we are doing. And I think it's just to make sure that they know that the number priority for us and for them is their safety. So that's why we will not impose anyone to come to the office. The office will be open, but they can stay at home and work from home if they want. We make sure that we have a temperature check before they come to the office. We make sure that we provide them masks. We provide them with alcohol gels. So we want our people to be comfortable, to trust the company, to trust the management, and it's all about communicating as much as possible.
Yeah.
Well, like if I can answer that too, the milk bar. So I have a milk bar. It's called Frank Milk Bar, and we recently just opened up for deliveries, and a lot of our employees were hesitant because, you know, it's a very scary time and there's a lot of news out there and sometimes you can get overwhelmed. And so we were operating on a skeletal staff, 7 people doing 100 to 150 drinks a day. And it was very tiring. But one thing that was really important was the sense of being a community and working together to rise above this pandemic, because, you know, we're a small startup company. We don't have that much to keep us afloat for the next 3, 4, 5 months. And, you know, when we spoke to our employees, we said, listen, this isn't for our, let's say, profit. It's really to help keep the company above. And we're going to ensure your guys' safety. So, I mean, the little that we did was pick them up from their homes and give them, like, protective gear. And then they did the work. And
So
I think it's teamwork also, and building that community.
So basically, just to summarize what we just both said is, take care of yourself, because by taking care of yourself, you take care of your family in a way, indirectly. It's about take care of your colleagues, watch out for each other, and help each other, and then take care of the society. And how do you take care of the society? Is making sure that companies at least key companies are still running, because we still need companies to run to keep the society running, so there is not a massive collapse. And those are the three important things we need to keep in mind at the workplace and the message we communicate to our employees.
Yeah. I think
taking care of yourself, definitely.
Yeah. And I guess taking care of your family gives you the peace of mind also, no? to be effective at work also. No? That's very important. No? I think, yeah. Brian, I think Adrien won this round. You know, that was very...
Adrien, 3.
What's the score? What's the score now?
He has 3. I only have 1.
Okay, 3-1.
It doesn't count this one. Because I use her answer to
okay, to, give to it to complete me. Mine. Who I'm so.
Okay. What is your prayer wish now for people now listening to us? You know, young families, and you know, I was in my notes to Belle. I was telling her that your age or the age of my former students. I used to work in Ateneo, so they're now around your age. So their careers are on the upswing. They're building their families. You know, and all of a sudden this pandemic. And so what is your wish as a young family and clearly as leaders in your own sphere of work? What's your message, your prayer wish, if you wish, not to put it that way? What's your prayer wish for people?
That's a big one. My prayer wish would for people in the Philippines. I think a lot of the Filipinos are very resilient. And we are very hopeful. So I wish that people don't lose hope and they don't think that, you know, this is the end of it and they're not going to be able to overcome this pandemic. I wish that they remain hopeful and resilient. And just really learning, I guess, gratitude and just being grateful for being alive and being able to be with your family.
Yeah. My wish is, because you said a while ago, and a lot of people are saying, "Oh, things will be different after." I don't know, but I really hope. So it's in our hands to make sure that this virus makes us behave a different way. And here I'm not talking about all Filipino. I'm really wishing that, and not only in the Philippines, worldwide, leaders, political leaders, head of companies, will have a different approach in the way they lead their countries or their companies. I'm always very impressed by Filipino, because they are actually content with what they have, and
resilient
and very resilient. And that was always something that impressed me the most about Filipino. They don't have a lot, but they are so happy. They are smile, and I think it's a lesson for all developed country. And we have to learn that lesson. So the thing is, all the rich, us, all the people who lead, who have power, I really hope that this, what's happening now, is gonna make us be more sharing, more
generous,
caring, and redistribute the health that we have on Earth that is huge, but unfortunately not very well distributed. So I really hope there will be a change. Otherwise, we're going to be in another crisis for a deeper change. So, change mainly usually come after a big crisis. I think it's a big one. So, I hope it's going to be a better after for everyone in the Philippines and in the world.
You're going to watch this interview and you're going to be like, "What did I just say?"
No, but I think I give Adrien this round, Belle. Sorry. Adrien wins this round.
No, he's just being kind to you. No,
thank you.
No, but
no, yeah. I think.
Go ahead, please. Yeah.
Well, I was just gonna say, I agree that it's up to us how this is going to play out, and we have to also be strategic. And yeah, it's tough.
It's tough, but we need to. I think we need to do what we can. I think we don't need to wait for the pandemic to blow over. We can start now. Actually, we can start now. I agree with what Adrien is saying, that, you know, it's really a question of people with the resources and the power to build a better world after this. You know, otherwise, you know, all of this suffering and all of this fear that we're going through will be pointless. No? But if we can build a better world after this, then it would have been worth it. You know, all of this sacrifice. No? Now, I'd like to thank you. I have to be very honest. I got more than what I expected. Adrien, I was telling Belle, I gave her the outline. I said, but we don't need to stick to this. And I'm glad we did not stick to my outline. I'm glad that I simply let you speak from your heart, from your soul. I think a lot of people will learn from this, and especially, you know, you're both very, you know, you're really just reaching your prime, and yet you've shared, I think, wisdom. Basically, that you shared so much wisdom today, and I hope we can continue this conversation, hopefully. And Adrien, I hope I'm gonna ask permission from you. Belle and I are gonna think of something. We're thinking of something, but we'll talk about that outside of this recording. You know?
Yes.
Okay.
Sure. Then maybe also, Adrien, please consider, you know, when we organize different fora here in the Philippines to the younger businessmen, hopefully you could give a talk or two one of these days in the future. You know, when,
okay. Of course, I'll be happy. Just if you give me an opportunity, I'll be happy to.
Yeah. Yeah, because I think one of the things, the wisdom you can bring is you also look at you're with a global brand, no? So you have a different perspective. Again, thank you very much, and hopefully we'll continue to work together, communicate, and maybe you can. I'll let you say goodbye. I'll let you say goodbye. Goodbye to people. You'll be the last. It'll be the last scene in this conversation. Please go ahead.
So before we say goodbye, I just wanted to also remind people that maybe this is the time. I know that social distancing is obviously what we need to do right now, but maybe this is the time to reconnect with friends, family, or old childhood friends who you haven't seen or you haven't given the time to chat with because you were just too busy. Maybe take the time now and really build a connection and ask people how they're feeling, because that simple gesture can also make someone else feel really good. So that's it.
Yeah, and me, maybe what I just want to share that, so every one of us is a leader in our own area, right? So every one of us has wisdom. It's not only us, everyone has wisdom, and everyone has to learn from the other, and everyone can share about where they're good at. So the thing is, I really want to learn from a lot of Filipino. I'm really impressed by the resilience of the Filipino, and I was very, very happy to live 10 years in the Philippines, and it's my second home after France, or let's say 50-50, the same. So have a good Easter weekend, and thank you, Father, for giving us the opportunity.
Thank you very much, and happy Easter.
Happy Easter, everyone. Stay safe.